Minuet, very strange piece, beautiful piece. Passepied, also one of a kind. I don't think there is a kind of... Maybe you could compare this passepied with the aria of the fourth partita, but it's not the same. It's very beautiful. And then a very tricky jig. It's tricky because it is difficult. It is a, what should I say, Bach is exploring all parts of the keyboard, and the higher you go and the more dense the texture is up to the treble. So for instance, he starts very high, with his second voice entrance on the D, and he goes actually even higher with the second voice. And so you have to make a full kind of legato sound. Cantabile sound is a better word because it's not legato as we understand it today. But cantabile legato, there's a lot to say about that. So that's a tricky piece, and it's technically very demanding because for all the partitas, the six, this jig, but the sixth one, the six is a very unique piece. But I'm just checking. I think the fifth one has the complete independence over the three voices. The first one is of course difficult in the way that you have to cross your hands. But here in the fifth cheek, the middle voice is jumping from left to right hand in a way which is very difficult to play, and certainly to keep the voices all cantabile. So you shouldn't hear that. It shouldn't sound difficult because it's a very joyful piece. I have been tuning the clavichord today again. Just checking. Don't like the A. The strange thing, weird actually. If I tell it to you, you will say I'm crazy. But it's not. That's my first tune. Through the live stream, the way the color of that tone is changing. It's rather dry now. That's okay. But you can feel that's the A that, you know, there is a tuning pin that did break. Evelyn accidentally pushed against the lid a few weeks ago. There's a video online. And my tuning hammer was still on the tuning pin, and so of course that's an enormous power. And it broke, and so the string has been replaced. And it takes a while before it gets in line with the others. I must say, I'm sitting here at the worst place in the clavichord. As with almost every instrument is the case, the position of the player is the worst position. But if it sounds okay here, I can be assured that it sounds okay also where the sound is being captured in the microphone. So, but last thing about tuning, what I was telling you. If you have done a retuning of an instrument, and certainly with the clavichord, it needs a little bit time to harmonize, literally. It settles. I don't know how, but it's a kind of frequency balancing. So if freshly tuned clavichord is needs some massage, so to say, finger massage. But overall it's very stable. Okay. We're going to do, and that's really the last thing, but maybe some of you exciting, and I'm really excited about that as well. I'm trying to figure out how to make these live streams. Of course, this is a recording session, and there is not too much interaction between the recordings and at the end, at the beginning a little bit. that how to enhance the interaction. And for the future live session practicing hours, we're going to implement, maybe not each time, but from time to time, maybe every 2 weeks, 3 weeks, or every month, I don't know, a Google Hangout implemented in the live stream. So that means that instead of writing questions in the chat, and again, I have to figure out how to get to you, because what you need to do is first go to the live stream, then there is a link, and if you click on that link and you have a webcam and a microphone, we actually can talk to each other and you are live in the live stream as well. So instead of asking the questions or remarks or just things you want to share through this chat, we can just talk. And it's about 20 people we can have in the live stream like that. And I've done it now a few times with other creators, and certainly now in the Video Labs course, where, and in fact it works great. And maybe also have some other hangout just to get to know each other would be great. And something that's really the last thing is I'm thinking about having one last live session to close the recordings of the partita, so when it's done, and playing them all six in one session just to close. Would be great also for me to better nice, so to say, the experience in my memory, getting better all the time then. Great. Let's go to the minuet. I think we can just start recording.
Okay.
Yeah. Hope so. We just continue with the passe-pied. Pretty piece this. On the concert I would play it a little bit different in a way that I would get safety first, of course, because it's really tricky, all those parts. But now I wanted to have all the left hand stuff equal in sound, and that's really hard. Because the clavicle certainly here wants the sound immediately. And so playing fast, relatively fast, I mean fast in a way, fast attack, fast release, and not making too much sound is tricky, but it shouldn't sound like that. And there we go. tape still running?
Yes, but if you want to...
Okay, just continue. We might go back, we're not proceeding to the sixth one, but I might play some parts of the second partita again. Is that okay?
Yes.
Okay.
But I have to rewind now.
Yeah, you rewind it. So, that last line, that's really killing you, because that's all the exceptions of the exceptions are there. The left hand, as it begins with a trill, but then it has to take over the second voice. So while ending the trill with this Nachschlag, you have to jump. And then, so middle voice is tom, boom, but other, lower voice, the bass voice, and then upper tones. This is very difficult on clavicle. By the right hand, it's just that, and it's six notes against a trill that has a fallen line at the end, because the trill itself. Against four on the right hand, while in the middle voice you have this eight notes. Dom, bom, dom, bom. So difficult, really difficult. And I wouldn't say unplayable, but it's on the edge, it's really going very far, and for that time it's really beyond anything else. I once was, and that's just to make the bridge a little bit with the second partita, and I just want to feel the second partita again. It sticks in my head, and just try it, maybe not too long. But we once were at a fair, so of hi-fi equipment, with all the analog equipment, or all the analog recordings and the vinyl productions and things like that. So we thought we better inform ourselves and went to some hi-fi fairs. What's really a world opening. We have heard loudspeakers that you would fall in love with, actually, but after hearing the price, love was over. But anyway, and in the analog world of analog recording, there's a great network as well. So I have a lot of people worldwide who's actually never quit listening to vinyl discs or analog recording. There is a surge of tape recorders again, so like we have, there are a few tape recorders there, and so also there you have a market, very 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 niche market of duplicated tapes. So really, if you are not familiar with that, it's crazy. People, some very small companies specialize this in a kind of music, kind of niche, most of it is jazz, and they hire the original tapes, which you cannot imagine have been preserved, and some of them are in bad condition, but most of them must be good because you can hire them, and then Sony or EMI or whatever or is sending that to you. But I don't think they would send it to me, but there is a procedure, and so those tapes are being duplicated. And they are extremely expensive. I think you pay around between 250 and 300 euros for one tape, and then it's the tape for 30 minutes. So also vinyl disc, but anyway, what I wanted to share with you is, Magnus, there is nothing wrong?
No, it's ready.
Okay, just cool down a little bit with that cheek in my mind. And so I was telling you this with the purpose, with those bars in mind. And we were sitting at the conference then, and there was a discussion about one of the things that's really hot, so to say, in that field is live recording. So many of those recordings, jazz of course, are live recordings. Many of those recordings have been recorded while on stage. So, and I can understand that, and the public there also enjoys hearing other people scream or clap or whatever, so it's very lively and it's live. And then came a guy who said, yeah, for classical music that should be the case as well, but that's the reason, one of the reasons that classical musicians are not tending to go to analog, because they don't practice enough. It was so stupid, I wanted to stand up and say, well, here's a score and play this, but of course that's not how it's how we in the classical music record, so life is almost impossible because things happen, and the level of perfection that is being expected from us and also expected from ourselves, I think, doesn't allow you to just go in there and grab the moment. So, and certainly passages like that, you cannot predict how they go. When the concerts are, I will always reach the end, of course, but if all trills are really that clear and that pure, I cannot guarantee on up front. And for a live concert, that's not a problem. For recording, it is. Because if you would listen to that recording and time after time, there's the same little mistake, it wouldn't make sense. So that's just a story in between. To make the bridge to the second. I haven't prepared for that, but I just want to try. The Capriccio, just give it another try. Yeah.
So?
Yeah. Thank you. It's 0.1% better, not that much. You still there?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. That's a very difficult sarabande and so etherical. I don't know if that's good English. So you have to place everything so right, and if it just is there. But it was not bad. Maybe good, I don't know. I like the ending, although I think that's very un-Baroque. Yeah, it suppresses a little bit the atmosphere, such a sarabande, but I think it, we stop for today. Yeah? Okay. Let me see if there is live in the chat. Maybe you're all screaming, stop, stop, stop. And it's rolling, 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 rolling. Alejandro, I see. Robin, Philip, I've seen. Passing, Carol, CG Moron, Moron, I don't know if I pronounce your name right. So, see if I missed something, and you will update me.
There's a few questions at the end. So,
This is live, Elikem. It's a difficult name for us to pronounce. Elikem. Hope I pronounce it right. It's really live. That sounds right already.
Nate, I had a question.
Nate, here. I do have one question. What methods of technique or exercises does RIM I use in order to acquire proficiency? That's a beautiful word. On the clavichord. You're new here, Nathan. I know. I think you came through the channel of Ted Forbes, isn't it? So we have done a number of practicing hours before I started with the recording of the partitas and the rehearsing sessions of the partitas. And those practicing hours were on Sunday evening. We had, I think, 10, 12 of them.
Yes.
It was with three cameras, so you could see my fingering writing down. So I was practicing together with you or with the people who are watching and commenting and reading the chat. That was something I referred to at the beginning. I would like to implement Google Hangouts with that so that we can invite people if to attend those meetings and just speak to each other, and that we have visual would be great. So in those sessions I'm referring there because I'm to that because I'm talking a lot about technique. A wrist movement, release, relaxation, release of the key, attack of the key, and we're doing that in sinfonias now, or we did, and in the partitas it's the same technique but brought to several higher levels. So, but if you manage to play these sinfonias in that way, that's the way to go for the partitas. So I hope to answer that question for a part, so you can check those sessions out. They're all online, and it's too much to summarize now. It's a lot of things, but I'm going to make a series of videos about basic techniques of keyboard playing, applicable to clavichord, but also to other instruments. Let me rephrase this. So if you would acquire a quote-unquote perfect clavichord technique, you can take that one-to-one to other instruments, so harpsichord, virginal, or piano, not, but pianoforte you can. So, because all the things that you need to do on the clavichord, of course, have not the same effect on other instruments, but in one way or another, and I'm demonstrating that also in those sessions, you will hear the difference. And so there are a number of key elements that are really important for keyboard technique, if I may say so. And that sometimes I'm wondering that people are missing them. And that's coming up in 2017. We just have to find a schedule for that. We're going on weekend. This weekend, Anya and I have been married to, how many is it? 17. 17
years. We married in 2000, so it's not that difficult to count. So Nathan is studying Greek, and he does mathematics, so he can count this for us if you have trouble.
He's studying in Greek.
No, he's studying Greek to know about the mathematics. So.
Also, then you must make acquaintance to Kostas. If you have not seen music of him, I have done 6 or 7 pieces by Kostas Papazeferopoulos. He is a great composer, young guy, beautiful story behind him, and we're going to do a lot more with him, with his music. So he lives in Athens, so it would be a nice contact. Anyway, I just go through the chat. Mikael couldn't post a link.
Yes.
Yeah, that's possible. YouTube is
you can post links.
Very hard in that. If you send me a call, you want to send me a link in the comment boxes, I often find it in a spam folder, so that's a little bit
yes,
their policy.
Yes, this was about a question of Carol on that temperament.
I will discuss temperament. That's like asking the age of a woman, you know.
You don't ask.
You shouldn't ask, actually. But I
no, but Robin and Michael said where he could find it. So which video you made about it?
Political suicide, yes. And I'm still alive. And I made another video very recent. I think that's the Partita vlogging number 5.
Yes, I didn't know which one.
Yeah, and I had a title box temperament. And I thought, well, now I will lose immediately 50% of my subscribers, but in fact had no impact. So what should one do today to shock people? It's very difficult. But I'm going to pronounce that a little bit more clear in the near future, because it's so silly, actually, that we, in the quote-unquote historically informed performance practice, we came to a point where, in fact, we agreed upon some principles that the people living in the 60s and 70s, I mean living, agreed upon, and so that's just it. And temperament is one of those things. And I believe that many of those practices that we learned from the first generation, Agnes,
no, it doesn't work. It goes out.
Oh, so he was just switching off the camera, like a signal from, that's enough for you. So anyway, what I was saying is that many of those principles, I think many of those have to deal with being different from another group. And the group that was really very strong at that day was a piano player. That was really, and I have been in piano class in Amsterdam, which was a very high class, in fact, so a kind of elite conservatory, you can say, and I know how it is there. You don't do things differently. And so in order to exist, you have to be different. But I believe that of course, since the 18th century, 19th century, you have different layers on top of everything that the composer itself wanted. So you have new instruments, new practices, new technique, new insights, new gestures, new colors, new things people like and don't like anymore. And we should not forget that throughout the history, there is only evolution. People never look back. It started actually in the end of the 18th century. But people like Mozart, they started to play music of Bach again. It's not Mendelssohn who invented or repositioned Bach. He did it in a brilliant way, but that's another story. But in the 60s and 70s, when people like Leonard came on stage with their harpsichord, they chose harpsichord. That was also an accident. They could have chosen the clavichord, and the clavichord would have the status of the harpsichord today. So it's not, I think it's bad English, but betonized, you know. And by saying that, there are a lot of things that we should reconsider, I believe. And also we put the context around of so-called first generation who has given us a kind of insight, sometimes with a lot of research, but in other cases, and I know it firsthand, not always, but we take that for granted. And so temperament is definitely one of them. And when I was saying, just to give an example and to close the session maybe, which is an interesting topic, and I don't want you to think that I'm avoiding it, but it's just like really asking the age of a lady today, because there was a year ago someone talking about temperament on Facebook, and I was like, we have to kill that guy. Really, literally, it's emotion. It's people are attached to what they're used to, and I understand it very much, but facts are facts. So when I was saying in that video a few weeks ago, I'm tuning according to Regmeister 1707, I don't think anyone knows what that is. But for me, that the Bach temperament has no secrets. There is absolutely not one single mystery about the temperament that Bach used. It is obvious. And if you just read all the articles and the sources that you can find, and there is actually a very beautiful article written by Groesbergen, which is the harpsichord builder. He built the harpsichords for Leonard and Ton Koopman. So he's not Mr. Nobody. He just summarized all the sources that he found regarding temperament. It's asking for the obvious way. So Regmeister 1707 is the temperament that I'm using, and it's been called by Regmeister the Wohltemperierte temperament. So 1 year after is that published. So the connection with the Wohltemperierte Klavier of Bach is obvious. And also the connection with the fact that if you want to play in 24 keys, you just tune all the fifths a little bit more narrow. That started in the 17th century, and that's what we today call equal temperament. But equal temperament, like a piano tuning, is today more in the sense that you have a relative impurity of the fifths. And I will not go into detail here. I will do it in the sessions that I will video that I will be recording. But if you have an absolute differentiation between the 12 fifths, you have kind of different thirds. Yes, it's equal temperament and equal temperament are two different things, but it's obvious that if you want to play in 24 keys that you use that temperament. Neidhardt, 1 year later, would call that same temperament the Gleichschwebend. So, and then you have all the sources in the 18th century except one, Kirchenberger, 1770, but Kirchenberger is a very special personality. You have to see him in his context, and even the Kirchenberger temperament that's used often today, it's impossible to play in a lot of keys, and even Kirchenberger himself was saying that. So I sometimes wonder why we mystify things, and you can have your own temperament. And it's, if you would ask if this clavichord today was tuned perfectly according to Regmeister 1707, which basically is take all 12 fifths and make them 1/12 narrower, of course not, because the instrument lives, and I am adjusting sometimes, like for the fourth partita, I lowered the F sharp to have a more beautiful beginning chord. So that's my personal taste, but the principles are there. So and it's difficult to pronounce that as a musician today, but I want to step a little bit forward with that, because I believe that we should give new life and new blood to the historical informed performance practice. We are not even close, I think. We make beautiful music, and not, I'm speaking in general, there are terrific musicians. We have instrument builders that are capable of doing things that were not possible in the 60s and the 70s. But overall, it's like we are satisfied with everything, as if we can imagine how Bach played, how Mozart played, and I'm sure that there is a lot to be discovered, and that was different in that time. We will come in the near future with a new project. It's a huge project for Authentic Sound, a book publication, not by me, about tempo, metronomization, and chronometer, so which is a pendel notation of French music. That's mind blowing if you read that, and that implementing that theory would have a major impact on our knowledge on late and early 18th century music. So, and that's the amazing thing of our time, that we have access to all that information. So let's use it and let's share that. Well, that was a long answer, and it wasn't meant to be that long.
I didn't see any questions anymore.
Okay, but that's coming up. I will explain myself and just don't keep you in the uncertainty for what I'm doing on my clavichord. And I will give you also the reason why I came to that tuning temperament. I didn't read first. I came to it before I understood that it was also this, actually the logic thing that appeared from the sources. At least as I see it. Okay. Thank you for recording. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for playing.
Oh, it's a pleasure.
It's Monday. Is your best recording day, I think. Isn't it?
I don't know. Mm. I don't know. So I hope I didn't offend you too much with my openness about my temperament. I feel safe saying Werkmeister 1707. I mean, makes sense though. Have a nice evening, night, day, depending on the spot on the planet where you live. And tomorrow we are virtually in the United States with video session, with Video Labs, with Tim Schmoyer, video creator. So totally other aspect of what we are doing.
Totally?
Well, it's not the same as playing music. It's understanding
but
the YouTube
platform.
But it's
talking also.
I will be very silent because there will be an author of a book of Primal Branding, Patrick Handel, will be there, and so it's kind of impressive all. So, and Wednesday, 6 partita. Thursday, 7 partita. 7 partita. 6 partita.
Okay. I didn't know he write another one.
He was planning to write, I think, 9 or 10.
Okay.
Okay, but Thursday and then Friday, Saturday, Sunday, we are on the weekend in the beautiful castle where we share about that with you. Okay.
Okay. Goodbye.
See you next time.
Yes.
Bye.